what happens is whenever anybody's speaking, it's now going to have to always
move over, move to the mentors. Yeah, well, unless they speak on one from one chair.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it always makes you up there, yes, you know.
It's over here.
Yeah, just sit on one chair because he's speaking, just come to one chair. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah,
same thing.
Yeah.
They change chairs?
No, man, one chair, one chair. So only makes us go. Let's leave only makes one. There's too many mics moving around. You know?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You know, so if I want to speak, then just come.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, exactly.
It would be best that if you put the mics at one end. So whoever is getting up will
just come to one end?
When
it was made of central,
for
the cameras and everything, I guess, is central.
Okay. Right on the middle.
Yeah, man.
So I would be chair, but then the problem is that...
when you finish, you just move across and somebody comes here, see?
Oh, I mean, to introduce everyone else?
Yeah.
I'm the one that has to coordinate who's speaking when.
Right.
So let's go together.
That is why I was saying, if there was... There's no podium. So if there was a team at the end, then whoever here would get up and go in here and they move back to their seat. But as you say, maybe one or two together. So let me see.
You can still be on the end.
Yeah. Because that's not really the microphone. All the microphones. To introduce. You agree with that?
Uh-huh, but if I'm introducing, I'm giving an overview and all that.
Oh, no, that part time. That time
that
you
would be necessary.
That time you remain. No, that time.
Jasmine on JS Macron.
Yes, yes, I do. Okay.
Good morning, everyone, ladies and gentlemen. We are gathered here this morning for the pre-launch meeting and release of the Manifesto of the Dominica Labour Party for this 2014 general election. And I would like to welcome the Prime Minister, the Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit, the members of the head table who are here. Shortly we shall be welcoming Peter Sejean. We also have with us Ms. Roslyn Paul, who will be speaking on social transformation. Mr. Cassius Daru, speaking on employment, youth, and family affairs and sports. And the Honorable Ian Douglas, speaking on the drivers of the economy, tourism, agriculture, manufacturing, services, etc. I would also like to welcome all of the candidates of the Dominica Labour Party in this general election who have been working very hard already and have at just less than a month hard work ahead with them, particularly to the students who are gathered here together, the present voters and future voters of Dominica. And we are holding it in this forum because of the importance of education and the association that education has played, particularly within the last few years. We're in this wonderful building, the State College building here, and therefore it's to basically focus on the importance of education in this highest position of education in this country, here at State College. I'd also like to invite the media and our listeners and viewers. The program here is going live on Kairi and on Marpin Channel 13 and online at liberkatwavai.com. We're going to start with our national anthem, the first verse, together as a prayer. That's our singing for our nation. And together we will begin. Isle of beauty, isle of splendor, isle to all so sweet and fair. All must surely gaze in wonder at thy gifts so rich and rare. Rivers, valleys, hills and mountains, all these gifts we do extol. Healthy land, so like all fountains, giving cheer that warms the soul. Thank you all very much. It may be an uncommon sight to see me at the podium here with the Dominica Labour Party slogan and symbol before me, but I was invited by the Honourable Prime Minister to be chair here today because we wanted to emphasize the seriousness of this exercise, that a manifesto is indeed a plan, a route for the years ahead, but also noting the achievements of the years before. And for this reason, I have been asked to be here to chair this morning's function. It is indeed a pre-launch event. The real launch will be at 7 p.m. this evening at Trafalgar, but it is to associate leaders of the community, civil society, private sector, public sector, and indeed the students of Dominica about the plans and programs that are within that manifesto. But I have another link with the Dominica Labour Party, which goes back at least some almost 60 years. And this is the association with Phyllis Chandolfrey, who was the founder, along with Emmanuel Christopher Loblack, of the Dominica Labour Party back on the 25th of May, 1955. And I inherited from her all of her documents related to the foundation of the party. And so therefore, having my possession, the archives and the early papers of those pioneering years back in the 1950s of the Dominica Labour Party. And as we gather here to pre-launch this manifesto of 2014, I want to just give you all a glimpse of the manifesto and the poster of 1961. Remember, this was an age when literacy is not as established as it is in Dominica today. And therefore, this one-pager was a poster and a manifesto. And a few words here were spread all over Dominica to indicate the program of the government. And as we are about to launch a much more complex manifesto, because in the last 53 years, the life and times of Dominica have changed from those early days, I just want to read what that early manifesto had. And it just takes a minute or two, because encased in all of that were the ideals of that early Labour Party that would go on in January 1961 on the basis of this manifesto to win their first term in government and continue on for another four terms. The Labour Party of Dominica election manifesto. At last, Dominica has her greatest opportunity to put into office a Labour government for the benefit of the people. Our Labour Party offers to the voters of Dominica a group of candidates chosen by democratic selection who are well fitted to govern Dominica wisely and honestly. We promise that, if elected, we will represent our constituents as their legislative servants and will report back to those whom we represent faithfully and regularly. We believe that the first things must come first, and that the basic needs of our people are food, homes, health, education, work. In order to achieve these things, we must have roads. Vote Labour, vote for yourselves, the Dominica Labour Party. Simple. That was the manifesto of 1961. I also possess the first constitution of the Dominica Labour Party, written mostly by Phyllis Chandolfrey and printed, financed by her in Trinidad when she was a minister of the Federation in Trinidad. And the same simple ideals that are maintained in that manifesto are the simple ideals that are maintained within this early constitution. It was a remarkable combination, those two people. Emmanuel Christopher Loblack, a working class roots man, a mason from Grand Bay, and Phyllis Chandolfrey, an intellectual, a former Labour Party worker in the British Labour Party in England, and someone. And so to today's manifesto. It has been put together by a group of concerned and technically expert persons, but it has been linked with interviews to candidates, to ministers of government. A wide cross-section have put their ideas into this document. And it covers a wide range of areas, and that is why we have this team here on the head table today. because they will be introducing some of the main parts of the manifesto. Essentially, the manifesto that is going to be launched tonight is based on three R's. It's realistic, and it's based on a realistic program. This is not a manifesto that has picked ideas out of the sky, waking up in the morning with another brilliant thought, with absolutely no consciousness of what kind of economy there is and where the money is to achieve these things. It's realistic because the people who have mainly contributed to put it together have worked and understand the economy and the realities of Dominica.
So it's available for them to play a leadership role in pursuing the vision and empower the Youth Development Division, NYCD, and other youth organizations to channel unemployment, unemployed young people into opportunities for work experience, training, and employment in fulfillment of the National Youth Service obligations. The Family and Community Act as a glue that holds our society together, and the stronger the family unit, the stronger the community and the country. The Dominica Labour Party would like every family to succeed. This desire is what underpins our education policies, our school transport support system, school feeding programs, free health care to youth under 18 and adults over 60 years old, and our thrust to provide decent and sanitary housing. A ministry of constituency empowerment was established to further empower communities, giving them an even greater role in participating in the implementation of local activities and projects. During the next term, the Dominica Labour Party will extend the provision of family life education in schools, continue to strengthen village councils and community-based organizations, create more educational, employment, and recreational facilities and opportunities in villages to stem the flow of migration to urban centers. We will continue to identify challenged families and individuals and guide them to opportunities for enriching their lives. Enhance the power of local authorities to ensure that each community gets a fair share of benefits. We will equip all community centers with modern facilities, including access to information and communication technologies for education, training, conveniences of e-government and e-commerce spots. When the Dominica Labour Party came to power in 2000, there were no modern sports facilities in the country, a well-established system for encouraging sports and producing super athletes. Since then, Dominica, like all its neighbors, has fully embraced a new perspective on sports in order to A, encourage healthy lifestyles to reduce the incidence and cost of chronic non-communicable diseases, B, create opportunities for lucrative career, not only as athletes, but also in all other dimensions of sports, such as organizing and staging sporting events, and C, help in diversifying the tourism industry with sports tourism. The modern Windsor Park Sports Stadium, built as a gift from the People's Republic of China, has subsequently hosted the World Creole Music Festival, the National Youth Rally, the sports festivals. Some of the highlights in lifting sports to a higher level in the new term include introducing a new sports act, establishing a national sports council, building an indoor sporting facility right here in Stock Farm that has the capacity to host regional and international games, provide training in Stock Farm for a range of sports and the emphasis on basketball, netball, and volleyball. constructing public tennis courts in selected communities, building an Olympic-sized swimming pool in Roseau, giving more support to sports club. Ladies and gentlemen, this snapshot from the many of activities that will guarantee a prosperous, peaceful, and just Dominica has been offered to whet your appetite and to deepen your commitment to support the Dominica Labour Party. The only party organized, respected, and connected to deliver on its dreams. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for listening. Support the Dominica Labour Party. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cassius Daru. And we're moving into the last lap now with a seasoned politician and Minister of Government. There's a nice mix here this morning between those who are the first-timers and those who have had years of experience in office. And this, in fact, is taking on the guise of a university seminar, which is the main point of the exercise, that we can take time and seriously analyze the manifesto here. And then tonight at Trafalgar, you will have a more spirited revelation by some of the keynote speakers that are so popular on the platform to launch this. The manifestos, as I said, will be delivered to those who have been invited here, and they will be more widely available around the country after tonight's meeting. And so, as the last presenter here on this panel, I would like to call on Ian Douglas, who will be talking about the drivers of the economy, the mixture of tourism, agriculture, manufacturing, and services. The Honourable Ian Douglas.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, Honourable Roosevelt Skerrit, members of the head table, the rest of my colleague candidates, other distinguished invited guests, students of the Dominica State College. We want to dialogue on drivers of the economy going forward into the new term. And we look at drivers of the economy as tourism, agriculture, manufacturing, and services. And I will also touch on geothermal energy, because I think that in the next term, geothermal energy is the axis upon which a lot of those drivers will rotate. First of all, we want to look at tourism. And in setting the way forward for tourism, what we did was in 2009, we did the tourism master plan. And the master plan really advised us that the focus of tourism development over the short to medium term must really be on our natural advantage, our comparative advantage here in Dominica. And that is the natural and topographical features of Dominica that can attract the visitors. And so that, in a nutshell, allowed us to arrive at the concept of ecotourism. Ecotourism that focused on our mountains, our rivers, our waterfalls, and our marine environment, like our diving and other water sports. But that study, even just as importantly, also identified some binding constraints to the development of the tourism industry. And the government had to really backtrack and focus on arresting and addressing those binding constraints before we could launch into the true development of the tourism industry. And the master plan identified some of those binding constraints as inadequate access, inadequate air and sea access. And of course, you know what we have been doing to address that binding constraint. 150 million spent on the upgrade of the now Douglas Charles Airport. And you have heard the Prime Minister speaking and told you that as a result of night landing, an additional 40,000 persons could access the destination after 6 o'clock. Also, to you, the Prime Minister today mentioned that he has just secured $12 million from the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela for port infrastructure and upgrade. And that is very important for us in the cruise industry. Also, to the whole issue of few market-ready rooms that was another binding constraint. We could not compete regionally and internationally with our neighbors as we wanted to because we had a shortage of market-ready rooms. Again, the government had to come on board, and we, again, through the diplomatic relations, aggressive foreign policy of the Prime Minister, and the friends that we have established outside there since coming into government, we saw the development of the Cabrits Hotel and Spa that is ongoing right now. And just last week, another exciting revelation was made through the signing of the memorandum for the development of the Range Hotel north of the Cabrits in Portsmouth, which is more popularly known as Bell Hall, to again address the binding constraint of the dearth of market-ready rooms. The weak tourism infrastructure was another binding constraint, and we have again started addressing that issue by the development of our infrastructure. The Liverpool Highway, the West Coast Eolibla Highway, just to name a few, the road into the valley where a lot of our tourism sites and attractions are some of the investments that we have made in upgrading the infrastructure. And going forward, like I just mentioned, the $12 million to be spent on the port infrastructure upgrade are some of the areas that we intend to address going forward. Also, too, we are going to increase our investment in destination marketing to continue to promote the name of Dominica in the international community, because that was another binding constraint identified through the master plan, which says that the name of Dominica wasn't as well known as it should have been in the international community, and we intend to invest in that. To address these constraints and to overcome some of the challenges, the government set about reducing some of the charges that are associated with accessing the destination, improving access, like I just told you. Again, we told you and we made a commitment to you. And if you look at manifestos past, every single promise that had been made from 2000 to today has been fulfilled or is in the process of being fulfilled. And so too, this manifesto makes the commitment that the international airport will be built. And the only way the international airport will be built in the next term is with a Dominica Labour Party, Roosevelt Skerrit led government. We will continue to attract a foreign investment for the development of the tourism industry. And it is through the economic citizenship program, the revised economic citizenship program, we have made the program more conducive for potential investors to actually come in now and actually invest in the tourism product. And that is what the Range Hotel is all about. It is through the economic citizenship program that we will get the resources to actually invest in the Range Hotel, which I spoke about, in the Bell Hall area north of the Cabrits, because we have to build more hotels. Even not far away from here, 10 minutes from here, on the public hook site in Fonkuli, we will actually build a new hotel around and in the vicinity of the capital city. We will continue to improve the overall infrastructure by the development of Roseau and Portsmouth. And in the budget, the Prime Minister gave the commitment, and you saw the various features of that development, what they will entail. And even now, you can see the hard evidence. If you go down to the riverside, you will actually see the first phase of the Roseau River Promenade in actual construction. So we're not just promising things to you. You can go and look at it and see the physical work actually has commenced even on the Roseau River Promenade. One area we believe, like I said, when I outlined the areas that we're going to focus on, that all of this will be made possible, is to move forward towards the establishment of a green economy. We believe that calling Dominica the nature island of the world is not just a cliche or a tagline. It is actually possible for Dominica to be the nature island of the world. And that is why we have spent $54 million. That's no mean feat. That's some serious investment here. $54 million in geothermal energy discovery and exploration. And you can actually see the steam being pumped out of the drilling that has been done in the Roosevelt Valley. That's actual work happening. And in the next term, we'll continue to invest in the realization of geothermal energy. First, to establish a domestic plant, because we believe that our hotel plants are burdened by high energy cost. And in a move to make our hotel industry more competitive with our neighbors, cheap energy is a vital component of that trust. That is why we are moving straight ahead into the exploration of geothermal energy and that massive investment of $54 million into geothermal development. In services, we will continue, like I said, to pursue the Citizen My Investment initiative so that those initiatives can lead to the development of things like the Range Luxury Hotel. This is, in a nutshell, what we want to do going forward in the next short term, 5 years, in the next medium term, 5 to 10 years, and in the next long term, 10, 15, 20 years under a Dominica Labour Party-led government. We believe that there must be a synergy between tourism and agriculture. Because we brand ourselves as Nature Island of the World, and we market Dominica as an ecotourism destination, we have already started crafting in the minds of our visitors that they are coming into the Garden of Eden, and they expect our services and the products that we offer to reflect that. And so that is why we are pumping more investments into the agricultural sector. More than any other government in a post-independent Dominica, this government has continued to invest in agriculture. We have spent $1.9 million we have given to the aid bank to establish a 50-50 grant loan initiative where farmers can go into the aid bank. You have your business plan, it's properly formulated, and the aid bank will give you half of that money towards the development of the business plan and putting it together, and half for the investment of that idea. And so you only have to actually pay back 50% of that. And also too, we have been subsidizing the price of fertilizer because we recognize the importance of fertilizer to the agricultural industry. Subsidizing the actual and real cost of fertilizer by 40% for the farmers of the country. And we could only do that because we have brought about a healthy economy that can now sustain that kind of program and initiative. We have actually built 2 packhouses because we believe that when the produce leaves the farm, it must reach the market in a market-ready condition, ready for the consumption of the consumers. And so we have built 2 packhouses so that our produce can reach the market, whether it is the domestic market, the regional market, or the international market, in a proper and acceptable way. And so that is why we will also to invest in transportation in the next term. We will actually buy a boat to transport farmers' produce out of Dominica into the region in places like Guadeloupe, Martinique, St. Lucia, St. Thomas, Barbados, and so on. We will continue the building of the abattoir because we believe that our locally produced meats is in fact what should be on our table. There are several benefits, like I said, even to the tourism industry. I will tell you that the tourism industry consumes about $70 million worth of agricultural produce, produce that is actually produced in Dominica, meats, fish, vegetables, and other ground provisions. And so we believe that we have to continue to invest in the abattoir. In entrepreneurship and micro business, we will continue our support for the private sector and to the private sector, because we believe that it is only with a strong private sector that we can continue to move forward, hand in hand, forming a partnership between public and private sector. And we have several initiatives that we will outline going forward to support the private sector. A lot of our initiatives, the NEP, the DYBT, the monies that we have placed at the aid bank, at the National Bank, all of that is in an effort to support the private sector. So, in a nutshell, these are some of the issues in tourism, in manufacturing, in services that we intend to focus on going forward. Thank you very much, and I'll see you tomorrow.
Ian Douglas, was that last statement, I will see you tonight?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. We will see you tonight. And so we have it, ladies and gentlemen, a quick overview. It has gone on, but everybody was giving an overview of particular aspects of the manifesto. You see already here some of the pages displayed, and you will be able to get your own. I think there are something in the region of 10 or so thousand that have been printed, so that they would be widespread throughout Dominica. We were hoping to get everybody to be able to leave by 1 o'clock. We have a couple minutes left, and on the program we have question and answer session. And I would like to encourage anyone who has any particular questions for any members of the panel to raise those points. Yes, Dr. Dublin. You can either come up here or you can raise your voice. Thank you very much, Dr. Dublin. A number of those items covered in the manifesto, but it is good that you query and bring up issues. Just to remind you that the Prime Minister mentioned at the renaming of the highway, Liverpool Highway, that at Pontcassé there would be a Kalinago's monument. which will be put in during the course of the coming year. I don't know if there are any, Mr. Yes, sir, please. If you'd like to come to the platform, I don't think it will make it any easier because there is no public address system within the room. As a good trade unionist, your voice would be. Minutes until one, and I will. We have two. Okay. Yes. Come for. Student at the back. Yes. First of all, was there a student who put forward? In? Okay. Yes.
We have read articles and heard of news items that other Caribbean countries, many of them, envy your leadership to Dominica. Many people, including myself, as a writer, would like to write your story. However, we would like to know, when you do retire as the Prime Minister, what would you like your legacy to be?
When you do retire as Prime Minister,
what would you like your legacy to be?
Very simple, very, very simple. It is simply that I love you and I love this country very much. I believe in people, especially the less fortunate. I believe a government has a responsibility to care for the less fortunate among us and to give everybody an opportunity to be proud of themselves, of the communities and the country. So I only want to be remembered as a young person. So I came into politics at age 26, became the prime minister at age 41 in the middle of an austerity program. So I simply want to be remembered when I retire, because at the end of this term, I'll be 20 years in politics. At the end of the next term, 20 years in politics. And I will still be less than 50 years old. So you understand how long I've been in politics. But simply, honestly, simply as loving Dominica and loving his people, nothing else. Nothing else. Not for the State College, not for the rural country. And this is why I have taken a very personal interest also in the Kalinago territory. Because for too long I felt that politicians had taken this for granted. And there's no way we could have allowed the poverty rate to be at as high as 70% in the Caribbean territory. And this is why we have spent significant sums of money. And now it's what always about 40% now. About 40%. And I intend to bring this poverty rate in the Caribbean territory to as close to zero as possible in the next term. But seriously, simply as loving you, the people, and loving this country. And I can say to you that I do not hold people on my heart and so on. I go to bed with the only concern of the people whom we have promised assistance and whom we have not helped, and those who are still struggling and the need for us to raise the resources to help them. So this is why my smile is a genuine, natural smile.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, we had two on, we have a third. Okay, students get priority. So.
I just want to say good morning to Mr. Prime Minister. Good afternoon, sorry. Mr. Prime Minister at the table. And to the other members of Cabinet and the invited guests here today. It's not a question, but I would like to thank the Prime Minister as a young person growing up in society that being a voter for the first time, it was a plate, I would say, well nourishing to my understanding for voting for the Dominica Labour Party. The Prime Minister and his cabinet have brought forth vital information to a young person as myself. And from my perspective, I saw that the Yes We Care program was something which was well thought out by the Prime Minister and his cabinet. Someone who thinks of the elderly people who brought up the country, Dominica, so to speak. The people who were there from time back. So, as sports has been one of the, I would say, trademarks for Dominica, going out there, representing our country, being ambassadors to our country. And Mr. Peter Sejan, for the education, I would say, you have given speeches that were, I would say to myself, I took heed that as a student, you have to know what you want in life and go forth for it because the economy is not very easy. So as I stand here today, I am thanking the Prime Minister and his cabinet for a well done job. And I just want to say, Mr. Prime Minister, to the opposition leader, just tell him we got this.
Thank you very much indeed. One more student over here. Yes, sir. You know,
if the world is to be invested from here, because then the media can keep it up.
Okay, good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Today, I don't really have a question. What I have is more of an advice. To the Prime Minister. First, let me take this opportunity to say thank you to the Prime Minister and his team. Over the past years that they've been in power, I have seen great improvement to Dominica. I have not been here all the time, but from since I came back, I can see a lot of improvement in terms of infrastructure, roads, and other stuff of that kind. I didn't spend the entire time here. However, I heard that Mr. Douglas touched on the building of the international airport and the improvement to the seaport. What I want to say here is that at that time, right before election, you have a lot of things that are said to sort of get people attracted to voting for a party. My advice is this. I would love to see that the Prime Minister and his team put a lot of effort into seeing the introduction of the International Airport here and the introduction of the seaport. Why? Because the limitation of access to Dominica, it prevents a lot of investors coming in. So if these two things are improved, then definitely you will have more investment. With the investors here, what you're going to create is a lot of employment for the young people. Hence, the level of brain drain that happens in Dominica, it will decrease drastically. So this is just my advice. I would love to see a lot of emphasis being placed on the development of the international airport and the development of the seaport here.
Thank you very much. I suppose PM and Ian Douglas, you have said your bit. It has been made clear. Yes, thank you very much. We'll try again. You could come up here if you wish, because it helps. Okay.
But I feel as a rector, as a musician, and music means everything you need, whether you come here, registration, newscast, everything you do, you need. And I am only thankful for this discussion. Please, if this is a manifesto area, I want to
Kem, who is the only one in Dominica who holds a manifesto, deal with the matter.
We gave a synopsis of what is contained in the document, in the manifesto. But I can say to you that the musicians have been properly captured. Just let me say to you, this is not a document I was prepared at the Labour Party's headquarters only. We had people whom we engaged, and also ourselves, who went across the country to have a series of focus group meetings across Dominica with various stakeholders, those in the private sector, those in civil society, students, the unemployed, the single mothers, across Dominica. And we have listened to their views, listened to their expressions, listened to their suggestions, and we have encapsulated those ideas and suggestions in this document. Obviously, not every idea will be captured because after analysis, it may not necessarily make sense at this time. Or also, you may not have the ability to raise the kind of finance required for it. So we have not mentioned every single thing in the manifesto. For example, we simply touched on the Kananego territory. But when you go on a section in the Kananego territory, you will see a number of very important actions which we shall take in regards to the Kananego territory. With regards to musicians, on page 48, page 49, we talk about the culture and the arts and a number of matters involving the financing for musicians, ensuring that we can build on our own recording studios, build on what we have, and also encourage those who would like to get into the recording, to get into the recording business. So financing will be made available for that. Financial made available to ensuring that the bandsmen can improve on the quality of equipment that they have. So we can compete with Guadeloupe and Martinique and Jamaica. And also having an annual extravaganza of all local bands to showcase our cultural heritage or our music, so that we can have a more motivation among those who are already musicians, but those of us who are aspiring to be musicians. We can certainly be motivated by those kind of actions. So you will hear more of that tonight, and you will have a copy so you can read for yourself and critique for yourself as to what is contained in the manifesto. So it is not everything, because you will certainly hear people saying, well, Skerrit didn't mention that, Skerrit didn't mention this. But get a copy, it will be online, and we will in fact give you the precise details as to how you can find it. So it will not just be online and you don't know whether it's a clothes line or fish line or whatever it is, and so it will be captured in there. But so your point is taken, but to say that you are well taken care of. And this was done by listening to musicians, engage them in discussions, and they telling us exactly what they would like to see a Labour Party government do for them and on their behalf, and so on. So that's captured. Okay?
Thank you. And now you were waiting quite a little while there. Yes. Would you like to come up so that Okay.
Bye.
How will you do it?
Well, we mentioned a number of things. First of all, as we started with regards to education, training, you cannot tell an investor come to Dominica to sell a business if you do not have people who will be able to help him with his investment and so forth. We have also sought to restructure our legislation, and a number of legislative actions will be taken that we have already taken and which we will take to cut down the bureaucracy. Because too many times people come to Dominica and complain that it takes too long to get licenses for this, license for that. So there will be more transparency in terms of the application process. If you tell somebody you need 5 documents, these are the 5 documents. Once a person has the 5 documents, there is no reason why that person should not get his license within 24 working hours or maximum 2 days and so forth. The other issue is that with regards to the infrastructure. And as you saw in the, what year was the manifesto from Labour?
1961.
53 years ago. It talks about food, homes, health, education, work. But it says in order to achieve these things, we must have roads, infrastructure. And that's what we have been doing, improving the infrastructure, spending hundreds of millions of dollars improving the infrastructure, the ports, the airports, and of course our move towards the international airport, our move towards the expansion of the existing ports in Dominica, all will help in transforming, making Dominica more attractive to the business. We're also using as a means of financial mobilization the economic synergy program by having the investment arm of the CIP as part of the economic synergy program. And Mr. Douglas mentioned to you that we've already signed an agreement for 125-room hotel in the Bell Hall area. There's an agreement signed, and we should start promoting this in a matter of weeks and so forth. So we're using that as a vehicle to raise the financing. We're also using in terms of financing, the aid bank, and through our bilateral partners, Venezuela, the European Investment Bank, and other the Export-Import Bank of China, to get concessionary financing from those bilateral partners through to the aid bank so that the interest rates can be reduced to 6% and 7% to cause investments to be cheaper. We have in place a task force made up of public and private sector actors who are looking at the existing legislations, making some recommendations, particularly in regards to tourism and related matters, and to take particular actions and so forth. The geothermal is also a major area, because every one of these businesses that are there, whether it is the supermarkets, whether it is the hotels, whether it is the barbershops, manufacturing in particular, they will tell you their major concern is high energy rates. They cannot operate with the high energy rates. We have no actions to take because it is imported fuel. And therefore, they are burdened with a high energy rate. And for them to be able to, first of all, maintain their plants, secondly, expand, we must find a way of reducing energy rates. If we want, we can go search around Dominica to see whether we have oil outside Dominica, you know. Or do we use what we already have, and we know that we have, to take advantage of and cause there to be a reduction in electricity rates in Dominica? And that's why, in the last 4 or 5 years, we have spent in excess of $54 million working on the geothermal energy with a view towards taking advantage of it commercially and thereby reducing the cost of doing business for the private sector and those of us who have to pay light bills every month, understand, to make it easier for us. So there are a number of actions that we have been taking and which we are continuing to take to cause Dominica to be a better place to do business. But critically, and this is why I spoke about responsibility, because the government can do all of these things, we can mobilize all of the resources. If we do not change our attitudes in the country, we're going to have a difficulty. So each one of us has a responsibility to play our part. So you now have to find out and decide, where am I in society? And what is it I can do? What is it I should be doing to help my country go forward? where do I want to see my country at in the next 5 or 10 years? And what will be my contribution? For example, our students there, their contribution is to stay in school, do well, not to drop out and go home and go on the blocks. They're here, they have an opportunity, they must learn, do well, move on, come back to help the country and so forth. You are a manager in the public service, you have to be more diligent. You have to show more patriotism. You have to show more willingness to want to go the extra mile to help the public service. You're in the private sector. You cannot want to have the car and the house that the owner has if you're not going to help him make more money. So you have to take charge of the business and treat it as it is your business. Because if he loses money, the first action he's going to take is send you home. So we have to recognize at the end of the day, we have the bird in our hand. And there's a little story where a young boy met this old man, so he had a bird in his hand. And in his mind, he says to himself, if the man tells me the bird is alive, I'm gonna squeeze it and kill it. If he says the bird is dead, I'll open my hand and let it go. So he went to the old man, he asked the old man, "Sir, I have a bird in my hand. Is it dead or is it alive?" The old man responded, "Young boy, the bird is in your hand." So it's up to us whether we want to kill Dominica or whether we want to see Dominica fly and soar to high heights. That is our decision.
Well, what a better way to end this university seminar that we have had here today than those final words. The bird is in your hand. Okay. I thought that it's getting on into after 1 o'clock, and I think that particular ending sums up what is the responsibility for all of us. And I would like to thank you all for being here and being so patient. This was a place where we sat, we listened, we learnt. And it is in the true spirit of what is achieved and is going to continue to be achieved for State College, this spirit of learning and concern for our country. And I think it is a unique way of pre-launching a manifesto. Tonight, you will get all of the powerhouse of speakers, and by tomorrow, there will be thousands of manifestos spread across Dominica. Study them, use them as a textbook, because that is the textbook for your future and the future of Dominica. Thank you all very much.